George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help? Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the best-selling book, From Glory Days, and your host of the show. Today's guest played professional baseball for 13 years. As a hard-nosed pitcher, he became an American League All-Star and won a World Series with the Detroit Tigers in 1984. Let's give a nice warm welcome to our guest, Dan Petry. Dan, great having you on the show. Lots of memories, lots of baseball memories. I remember one of the early things that I've heard about you is that boom, boom, boom on the garage door growing up out in California. How did it all start for Dan?
Well, I started off driving my mom nuts, you know, that's exactly what I did. And I have fond memories, actually, of replaying the 1968 World Series up against that garage door. I was the Tigers, and my friend down the street was the St. Louis Cardinals, and we had everybody's pitching mechanics memorized. You know, I had Denny McClain's high leg kick. Couldn't throw quite as good left-handed as Mickey Lolich could, but I had all the batting stances down and everything. So
yeah,
that's one of the things.
And being
early
in
days.
California, obviously being a Tiger fan, it wasn't too popular at that time, I'm sure.
You know, I think I just always followed the lead of my dad, and you know, he brought up the fact of how good the Tigers were, and of course Denny McClain had that huge year. You know, so I think that was, and he took me to an Angel game to see Denny win. I think it was about his 28th game. So I've got you know, a lot of those memories. I think I was about 10 years old at the time.
And at what point did you realize baseball was going to be a ticket for you of some type?
I don't know if you ever really figure that out. I mean, even though, you know, I was drafted and played in the minor leagues and started moving up the Tiger farm system ladder and everything, I don't know if you ever really know for sure that, hey, I'm going to get to the big leagues. And probably, I guess, when I got to AAA, it might have been, you know what, I'm knocking at the door and I'm this close. I started to get some big league hitters out, and that's when I figured, hey, I got a
you
shot.
You might have
here.
A shot at it.
I got a shot, yeah.
Yeah, and the neat thing is that often in a Tigers organization, you kind of grow up together. We talk about, you know, being the bus league or riding together, and you kind of grow up together. What were some of your best memories about playing for the Tigers?
I played at every rung of the ladder, from rookie ball to A ball, double A, triple A. And I don't think that happens a whole lot anymore. You know, I had a good chance to develop and really learn the game and play for some wonderful, wonderful managers who taught me not only about pitching but about every aspect of the game. But, you know, some of the best memories that pop in was those bus rides in AA where, you know, we didn't have sleeper buses, so they used to have those overhead racks where you'd put your luggage and everything. Well, you know, that was the only place you could sleep, so you had about, you know, a foot of room between that the luggage rack and the bus stop,
so
and we'd get up there and crawl.
Stretching out up in the top racks up
things,
there.
Yeah.
What thing got you there? What got you up to the big leagues, in your opinion?
I think it was, again, the guys, the managers that I played with, and I was fortunate enough to play for Jim Leland for 3 years, and he was one of those guys that really kept pushing me from day one, and it was down in A-ball where I first met him. But then I played parts of 2 years for him in AAA, and he would just always go the extra mile. And I think he was the one that really started to fill me up with that confidence of, okay, you're in AAA now, and then him continuing to push and finally giving me that little bit of extra confidence, I think, to put me over the hump to believe I could finally get there.
Yeah, because you mentioned that earlier, that up to that point, you really weren't sure if you were going to have a shot at it. And then all of a sudden, like you said, the confidence at that point that, hey, I do have a shot at it. And obviously, you know, the biggest thing was the championship or the World Series. What, you know, what kind of memories do you have from that?
And they'll never die. I mean, they're still wonderful, wonderful memories. They sometimes you need a little bit of prodding from your teammates to, oh yeah, I guess I do remember that. But you know, it's a great group of guys that will, it'll never go away. You know, we had our 25th reunion a couple years ago, and I'm sure we'll have, you know, hopefully a 30 and a 35th, and every 5 years have those. And it's that, you know, real close bond that you get for a lifetime by winning a championship like that.
And what was that like for you?
It was something that you dream about as a child, but I would like to have had a little bit better World Series, of course, you know, when I look back on it now. But when you sit there and you analyze other World Series every year, there's always some people that, you know, don't always, you got Hall of Famers that don't always perform. So, you know, you're able to, you know, get a hold of things and say, hey, the whole scope of things was for the team to win and not an individual performance.
So even to this day, you're still critical of your performance at that time, it sounds like, a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
Time has been good to you. Dan Petry, 84 Tigers.
Well, how many chances do you get? That's the thing. It'd be nice if you had 5-6 chances like the Yankees get sometimes, you know. But, you know, sometimes people don't even get one chance. So, you know, when you have that one chance, it you know.
You mentioned about the managers that you played for. Let's talk about some of those managers and the impact that they had on you with baseball, but even in life.
Well, I mean, Jim Leland probably did more for me than anybody in my baseball career. Mm-hmm. As I look back on it, I always thought it was Sparky, but when I really got down to thinking about it, I said, well, man, I mean, without Jim Leland, I never would have even got to Sparky, you know. So, but Sparky, more than anything, kind of prepared me for, you know, life after baseball, and that there was more to life than just baseball. There was being a human being, and of course we've heard so much about Sparky in the last year or so since his passing, that about what a great person he was with his catch organization, and how he loved children. So, you know, here's a Hall of Fame manager that certainly had a whole lot to do in life other than just baseball.
Yeah, and that was important to you because obviously baseball, like you said, was just a part of your life and one phase of your life. How did it start to end for you? When did you know that baseball was going to be something that was eventually going to end?
Well, that was the great thing about Sparky, is that, you know, he'd always remind you, you know, that someday it's going to end. I mean, and so I think you knew it, but I mean, he would kind of remind you about that, you know. And I forget exactly how the saying goes, but he had this little wooden frame up in his office that every 24 hours the world rotates over on the person who was on top of it, you know. You know, so yeah, every day is a new day, and you think you're on top of the world, and the next day, you know, you could be on the bottom, you know. So but I pitched a long time, you know, let's face it, and after a while you can tell that things are kind of starting to shorten up a little bit and you're starting to get hit around a little bit. So you got to change a little bit. So I think just at the end of my career, it was a 17-year career. It's a long time for a pitcher.
What did you do about changing? You said you had to change. You change your philosophy, change your pitching style.
You do. You know, I mean, you don't throw as hard, you know, so you have to invent some pitches. And I had to do that at times. And but, you know, still had a little bit of success, but still could have went on and played in some other leagues. But at that time, it was, okay, enough's enough.
What does Dan Petry invented something as far as, what was it you invented at that time?
You know, I found out against these big power-hitting left-handed hitters like a Don Mattingly and Cecil Cooper, Fred Lynn, George Brett, you know, these kind of guys, that my basic stuff was not good enough to get them out anymore. So I found out that the slower I could throw, the better. And so I used to throw these little spinning curveballs, and their eyes would get as big as saucers because, oh my gosh, look at this thing. This is slow as heck. And they couldn't hit it. They just hit little weak ground balls all the time and just used to get so mad, you know, like, throw the ball like a man, let's go, you know. And here I am spinning these little curveballs up there.
They're like, come on, where's it at? Yeah,
we're
looking
right
for the heat that wasn't coming, you know, at that point. So,
exactly.
And so you started doing that. You started changing your pitching style. You also started realizing that, okay, this is only going to be temporary. Tell us how that happened. How did the end for Dan Petry happen? I mean, what happened in the final week, the final day?
Well, my final year, I played, I was in Detroit, and I played up until about the middle of July and was traded to Atlanta. And that was hard. You know, I mean, I was back, and my son had just started kindergarten, and I think it was kindergarten. Had another younger son. And I went to Atlanta, new league, new teammates, everything like that, and absolutely hated it. I hated it down there, and I hated the league, National League. So after 6 weeks, I was traded to Boston, and back in The American League knew some of the guys on the Red Sox. Mm-hmm. We were in a pennant race, of course, so was Atlanta at the time, but I was a lot happier and performed a lot better for the Red Sox. But I played for three teams in 1 year, and I kind of thought that, okay, that's nobody really wants you at that point.
So when a chip in the armor of confidence started happening again, you think? Or what?
I don't know if it was that. I just... Now looking back, I know that I didn't really have valued anybody because, I thought myself as a starter, but I was like a five-inning starter. Mm-hmm. I mean, nowadays that's good, but, mm-hmm. 20, years ago, that wasn't so good. Mm-hmm. You had to be able to go, into the seventh inning. And then at the same time, middle relief, if I pitch, I wasn't good at pitching on multiple days in a row. Mm-hmm. So what good was I? I was a short starter, mm-hmm. and really couldn't be too much of a reliever. So I felt wonderful. It was great shape, but really didn't have any value to anybody.
So how did it happen? What was the end for you then? What was the decision? What determined it for
what
you?
What happened was I was trying to get a job, and I finally got one late in spring training had started. Mm-hmm. And it was my good old friend Jim Leland was with the Pittsburgh Pirates. And said, sure, Dan can come in and go to minor league camp. And mm-hmm. so I was in AAA camp. And, they came down and had nothing to do with the major league camp. But, Jim Leland would come and watch me pitch in some of the games and everything. And then I just got released and out of that camp. And that was it.
So. What's that like for you, being a World Series champion and then all of a sudden basically being told you're not good enough anymore? How did you handle that?
But I had prepared for it because of, Sparky's, wisdom. But, it certainly is a blow. I mean, mm-hmm. I'm not going to lie to you and just mm-hmm. say, it's no big deal. It certainly was a big deal. But, when you're used to having some success and you do have some pride, and you're beating your head against the wall for as long as I did, trying to maybe get back to, the glory days, mm-hmm. And it doesn't happen, you kind of say, okay, enough's enough. So mm-hmm. you kind of realize it.
You realize at that point.
The
writing's on the wall, so to speak.
Right.
The phone is not, ringing, it gets quiet, you're not getting calls from other teams, and so that happens at that point.
And I had a chance to go to Italy, after I was released, and I decided, nope, I got a young family, I'm going to stick around and start another life.
Yeah, good for you. Well, we know that professional athletes, when they're done playing, at least nowadays, take a 90% pay cut or more when they're done playing professional sports. And that's obviously a huge hit. Some of them have financial problems, bankruptcy, different things. It was a different era at your time. But what were some of the challenges that you came out when you came out of pro sports financially? Any at all?
I don't think it's a matter of you just have to know how to – When you're making a lot of money, it's making sure you don't spend it all, mm-hmm. and get used to living kind of within a certain means. So mm-hmm. when the day comes where you're not making those big paychecks, mm-hmm. You can get by on a little shorter salary.
You got something there at that point.
Exactly. Conditioning.
No, that's great. Well, we're going to take an educational minute right now. We're going to take a break for our educational minute. But when we come back, more from our guest, Dan Petry.
As a rule, if you don't fully understand something, you shouldn't invest in it. The financial services industry spends billions of dollars marketing new and crazy ideas every year. If you chase the latest hot trend and buy what everyone is recommending, you're almost assuring yourself of poor returns. Keep in mind that if thousands of highly paid professionals spend their entire lives studying the market and they can't beat it, neither can you. My advice for you is simple. Take a long-term approach to your strategy. Focus your investing in areas with a long track record of success, and write your strategy out so that you can refer back to it to rebalance your investments at least once a year. Now that's a formula for long-term success.
I'm Kurt David, and we're back with our guest, Dan Petry. Dan, when we left for the break, we talked about that life after pro sports, that transition out, talking about that at some point you knew it was going to be over, and you mentioned about how Sparky had prepared you for that. That was one of the things he did, was talked about that life after pro sports. How difficult was it for you?
It was hard, even though I was prepared for it, and Sparky did a wonderful job, as I had mentioned, but you're torn. I mean, it's something that you've done all your adult life, mm-hmm. and you still would like to continue doing it. And I didn't have any college education and really had no other jobs other than playing baseball. So mm-hmm. it was just, okay, now what are you going to do for the rest of your life? So mm-hmm. That wasn't scary, but it was just, what do you want to do? Mm-hmm. And so that was the next challenge of finding out something that I wanted to do, and I just kind of stumbled into something and been doing it ever since.
How do you handle that then? So you kind of stumbled into something is more or less how it happened. I know one of the things that we had talked off camera before was that you had to learn to write a resume. I mean, that was something at 35 years old, had to learn how to write a resume.
You know, but I turned back to baseball. The first thing I did was I went down and saw the Tigers president at the time, Jim Campbell, and said, okay, you know, I'm done. What do you think I ought to do? What, how should I approach this? And since the baseball season had already started, there wasn't going to be any baseball opportunities or anything like that. But, you know, he says, well, Bill Freehan, you know, he's a manufacturer's rep and has a lot of different things to do. Why don't you, you know, get a hold of him first? Hank Aguirre was very successful at the time with Mexican Industries, you know, get a hold of him. And so I went back, got a hold of all of them, and, you know, they didn't have openings necessarily, but it was, hey, you know, here's some other people, you know, the whole networking thing, you know, but it all started with, you know, some good friends that I got to know, not from the 84 team, but, you know, from, you know, the 68 team and the generation before.
The Tiger family, so to speak, you know, kind of found connections with that and everything. And so you had to learn to write a resume. You learned that you wrote a resume at some point.
Well, I didn't officially write it. I went to somebody that his expertise was to write resumes, but I did all the research as far as a questionnaire that he put together as far as what, you know, what are your interests, you know, strengths, things like that, and came up, and he did a marvelous job making a turd like me, you know, I hope you can say that, into looking like, hey, this guy's not so bad.
And it helped, right? You found a job.
I did. I actually had a couple of opportunities, and still, well, the one that I had was for 16 years, and I left briefly that industry. But
what were you doing?
I worked for International Paper, so I was in the printing industry. But I sold printing paper and called on advertising agencies, commercial printers in this particular area. But that also took me to California and the East Coast on press approvals for the automotive. So. But at that time, is that all there is? That's all I ever did since baseball. So I left and for 2 years worked for the Detroit Lions. So I got to see that, you know, was a season ticket holder, still love the Lions, still am a season ticket holder. And but now I'm back in the printing industry again.
So you played baseball, worked with the Lions afterwards for a little bit. You actually have a connection too in hockey now as well, I want to bring up.
My wife and I, that's kind of what consumes our time now is Jeff, our youngest, who went to Michigan State, Orchard Lake St. Mary's, and then off to Michigan State, plays for the Edmonton Oilers. And we have the NHL package, so we're able to keep track of him and watch just about every game. And then if he gets remotely close, we'll venture off to see him play.
No, that's great. And so you've got all the main sports except for basketball. I guess you got to find somebody in NBA to really tie that Petry family together at this point.
I got to talk to you. You're the basketball expert.
These days are over, no question about that. But so let's talk about some of the highlights. I mean, obviously, baseball is great, and like you said, it was one phase of your life, but now you've recreated yourself afterwards. What are some of the great things that are happening to you now? You know, not just the work part of it, what are some of the great things? And why is being in Detroit still, you were raised in California, why did you decide to stay here?
As soon as I got out, I coached baseball for forever until the kids got older and no longer played. But now my son is now the varsity baseball coach at Orchard Lake St. Mary's. So last year was his first year, so I'm his assistant, you know, and I'm back coaching and helping at that school, which is a marvelous school, great young men, and I'm back in baseball. So I'm working with my son, working at a great school and doing baseball, which I absolutely love.
So that's still involved with the sport at some capacity.
It's wonderful.
You think that helps as far as that transition? I mean, even now at this point,
you know, without a doubt. I mean, I was away from it for a few years. I gave some private lessons and everything, but nothing real organized as far as coaching it or anything, and that was okay, just doing the private lessons, but it wasn't enough. So now being back, I hope he stays a long time, because
keep you involved at that point
and doesn't fire me. You know, so
what do you miss the most about being a player?
I guess the feeling, because I don't want to say the competition, you know, the buddies, I mean, because those are, I think, natural things that everybody does, but the feeling of when you win and when you're successful, that's a wonderful feeling. And and I remember somebody being successful during the playoffs and throwing a real good game, you know, and after it's all said and done and you're sitting around in your hotel room after that game, it's a marvelous feeling, you know. And waking up that next day, you know, I mean, you're on top of the world and you're feeling really, really good.
You work to get to that point.
Yeah, not like in life now you're always miserable and you don't have, you know, days when you feel wonderful, but that's an awfully good feeling.
Have you found anything to replace that passion?
You know, there's still some things that I still, you know, when you get a nice order, you know, in sales, or when your customer is having a lot of trouble with something and you're able to bail that person out, that's a very good feeling. But I mean, let's face it, I mean, you know, it's not quite the same as
World Series.
Right, not being on the national, you know, mm-hmm. spotlight, but there still are some things that do give you a good feeling.
Able to apply that competitive edge into what you're doing now as well.
Right, right. And to see young people be successful, you mm-hmm. know, as well. But, you know, you also ask, you know, about, you know, staying in Michigan. And I had a friend of mine that tells me, he says, you know, Michigan has been very, very good to you. And I mean, last night before, I was thinking of all the great things that, these kind of things. I mean, I wouldn't be doing this if I was back home in California. Mm-hmm. Recently being asked to speak at Sparky's retirement ceremony. Mm-hmm. His number retirement. I mean, they asked me to speak. I mean, that was a great, great honor. I mean, that never would have happened if I was in California, you know?
Obviously a fan great as well. I mean, you're still a fan favorite around here.
I don't know about, you know, maybe the price was right or something like that, you know, but no, and working with Dan Miller during the playoffs.
Yeah.
I mean, those are just wonderful, wonderful things that even though it's been such a long time ago that, I actually played. I'm still involved.
Now you mentioned it. This is one of my favorite parts of the show. We actually have live studio audience question and answer, so some of those fans get a chance to still talk to you and ask you some questions.
Why do you think any members of the 84 Tigers don't get serious consideration for the Hall of Fame?
I remember when Sparky took the job, he said, I'm going to get everybody so much publicity they're going to be household words and everything because I know how to promote my players and everything. So I think, but that never happened. And I don't know if it just happens to be we're in this like nice little Midwestern little area, but there certainly should be. Lou Whitaker, Lance Parrish. I look at, you know, the guys, you know, Gary Carter, you know, people like that, you know, I mean, Lance was known as one of the best catchers, you know, rivaling Gary Carter at the time. So I'm not really sure why it happened. I mean, there's a couple of reasons why it could be, but let's just hope that a couple of the guys end up making it, veterans committee or not, just a couple guys make it.
Is the season too long, starting April 1st and lasting into November?
Boy, Mackenzie, that's the one that I like that talk. You know, there's a lot of things that bother me about the World Series being played in 30-degree weather. You know, you've got April, where it's bad enough, where opening day, it's a flip of the coin whether the day is going to be nice or if it's going to be snowing. But you play the majority of the season in tremendous weather. You know, it's very mild or the hot months of the summer. And then your championship is played in this god-awful, terrible, nasty weather. And it just doesn't make sense. So it would be nice to figure out a way to not necessarily shorten the season just because of records in baseball mean the most to people, so you need to keep that 162, but somehow formulate the schedule where you have everybody playing down south or playing in domes or playing on the West Coast in the warmer weather, or even having the season start down in Florida at the spring training sites. I don't know exactly what the answer is, but it would be nice just to, you know, continue to have it at that particular time, but, you know, just to somehow get it to where they're not playing in such nasty weather. And you know, if you can come up with that idea, you might be the next commissioner, you know. So that's a great question.
Well, Dan, this show is about the transition of professional athletes. But bigger than that, what advice would you have for anybody, athlete or not, that is facing a transition or change in adversity? What advice would you have?
I don't think you ever can, you know, stop transitioning. You know, I talked about being with one company and then going to work for the Lions and then back with another company, even though it's the same industry. So you're always transitioning. But I think the biggest thing is, and this is from my experience, is not to be embarrassed by, say, the failure of not being able to play a sport or failing at something and transitioning into, you know, it takes a while for you to find out what your niche might be, and not to be embarrassed to ask people that are close to you. And, you know, it could be, you know, your parents, certainly, you know, hopefully it is your parents. And regardless of what has happened recently in Syracuse and at Penn State, you know, there are high school coaches, there are college coaches, there's people that are close to you, your clergy, you know, a priest, you know, anybody at your church. I mean, there are people that you can go to, and they're more than willing to help you, and I think, you know, make sure that you're not feeling sorry for yourself, which you can't feel sorry for yourself because nobody else is. Mm-hmm. But there's a good number of people, but not to be embarrassed by it, and just open up and look to those mentors who can help you.
I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, Dan Petry, for joining us.
Thanks, Kurt. Thanks for having me.
Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions,
please visit my website at jwifinancial.com.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?